Hello, my name is Candace Grant, and I would like to welcome you to Poets' Corner. You're on Radio JCOM, and here is where we listen to a little bit of poetry. Today, my first poem is Spring, the Sweet Spring, by Thomas Nash. Spring, the sweet spring is the year's pleasant king. Then blooms each thing, then maids dance in a ring. Cold doth not sting. The pretty girl birds do sing. Cuckoo, jug jug, poo wee, to witter-woo. The palm and may make country houses gay. Lambs frisk and play, and shepherds pipe all day. And we hear, I bade birds tune this merry lay. Cuckoo, jug jug, poo wee, to witter-woo. The field's breath sweet, the daisies kiss our feet, young lovers meet, old wives a sunning sit. In every street these tunes our dear ears do greet. Cuckoo, jug jug, poo wee, to witter woo. Spring, the sweet spring. So moving on, my next poem is by Emily Dickinson. This is Light Exists in Spring, and it's not one of Emily Dickinson's best-known poets, but it's a fine poem about the spring season. A light exists in spring, not present on the year or at any other period, when March is scarcely here. A colour stands abroad on solitary fields that science cannot overtake, but human nature feels. It waits upon the lawn, it shows the furthest tree. Upon the furthest slope, you know, it almost speaks to you. Then, as horizons step or noons report away, without the formula of sound, it passes and we stay. A quality of loss affecting our content, as trade has suddenly encroached upon a sacrament. So, my next poem, keeping up with the spring topic, is Spring by Gerard Manley Hopkins. Nothing is so beautiful as spring, when weeds in wheels shoot long and lovely and lush. Thrush eggs look little low heavens, and thrush through the echoing timber does sow and ring the ear. It strikes like lightnings to hear him sing. The glassy pear tree leaves and blooms. They brush the descending blue. That blue is all in a rush with richness. The racing lambs have far their fling. What is all this juice and all this joy? The strain of the heaven's sweet being in the beginning in the Garden of Eden. Have yet, before it cloy, before it cloud, Christ, Lord, and sour with sinning, innocent mind, and May Day in girl and boy. Most, O maid's child, thy choice and worth the winning. And then my next poem is Today by Billy Collins. If ever there were a spring day so perfect, so uplifted by a warm, intermittent breeze that made you want to throw open all the windows in the house and unlatch the door to the canary's cage, indeed, rip the little door off its jamb. A day when cool brick paths and gardens bursting with peonies seem so etched in sunlight that you felt like taking a hammer to the glass paperweight on the living room table, releasing the inhabitants from their snow-covered cottage so they could walk out, holding hands and squinting into this larger dome of blue and white. Well, today is just that kind of day. So my next poem is Lines Written in Early Spring by William Wordsworth. I heard a thousand blended notes while in a grove I sate reclined, in that sweet mood when pleasant thoughts bring sad thoughts to the mind. To her fair works did nature link the human soul that ran through me, and much it grieved my heart to think what man has made of man. Through primrose tufts in that green bower, the periwinkle trailed its wreaths, until my faith that every flower enjoys the air it breathes. The birds hopped around me and played, their thoughts I cannot measure, but the least motion which they made, it seems a thrill of pleasure. The budding twigs spread out their fan to catch the breezy air, and I must think, do all I can, there was pleasure there. If this belief from heaven be sent, if such be nature's holy plan, have I not reason to lament what man has made of man?
I'm standing on a ledge. and you'll find the spider web is fastening my ankle to a stone. Now so long, Mary Ann, it's time that we began to love. Hidden love, I'm cold as a new razor blade. You left when I told you I was curious. I never said that I was brave. Oh, so long. Such a pretty one. I see you've gone and changed your name again. And just when I climb this whole mountainside to wash my eyelids in the rain, oh, so
So Long Marianne by Leonard Cohen. Ah, life is a gate, a way, a path to paradise anyway. Why not live for fun and joy and love or some sort of girl by a fireside? Why not go to your desire and laugh? That was written by Jack Kerouac. He was born of French-Canadian descent on the March the 12th, 1922, in working-class Lowell in Massachusetts. He was the youngest of three children. So here's another Jack Kerouac poem, and this one is Hitchhiker. Trying to get to sunny California. Boom. It's the awful raincoat making me look like a self-defeated, self-murdering, imaginary gangster. An idiot in a rueful coat. How can they understand my damp packs, my mud packs? Look, John, a hitchhiker. He looks like he's got a gun underneath that IRA coat. Look, Fred, that man on the road. Some sex fiend got in print in 1938 Sex magazine. You found his blue corpse in a green shade edition with axe blots. So, next poem, again by Jack Kerouac, is Daydreams for Ginsberg. I lie on my back at midnight, hearing the marvellous strange chime of the clocks, and know it's midnight, and in that instant the whole world swims into sight for me in the form of beautiful swarming mutter words. Everything is happening, shining behoodoo lands, booty blazing in space, faith. I know I'm forever right, and all I've got to do is hear the extant voices of ladies talking in some kitchen at midnight. Oilcloths, cups of cocoa, cardor to mump the rinnegan in this darling drain. I will write it. All the talk of the world, everywhere in this morning, leaving open parentheses sections for my own accompanying inner thoughts, with roars of me, all brain, all world, roaring, vibrating, I put it down. Swiftly, 1,000 words of pages compress into one second of time. I'll be long-robed and long-haired in the famous Greek afternoon of some Greek city. Fame immortal, and they'll have to find me where they find the nup of my shroud bags flying flak yagging Lucian. Midnight back in their mouths. Gore Vidal, be amazed. Annoyed, my words will be writ in bold, in gold, and preserved in libraries like Finnegan's Wake and Visions of Neil. Now then, just think, going back to Jack's life, he was considered a literary iconoclast, and alongside William S. Burroughs and Allen Ginsberg, a pioneer of the Beat Generation. Jack Kerouac is recognised for his method of spontaneous prose, and thematically his work covers topics such as Catholic spirituality, jazz, promiscuity, Buddhism, drugs, poverty and travel. He became an underground celebrity and, with other Beats, a progenitor of the hippie movement, although he remained antagonistic towards some of the radical elements. Okay, so let's have another poem, and this is 149th Chorus. I keep falling in love with my mother. I don't want to hurt her. Of all the people to hurt. Every time I see her, she's grown older. But her uniform always amazes me for its Dutch simplicity. And the doll she is. The doll-like way she stands, bow-legged, in my dreams, waiting to serve me. And I am only an Apache, smoking hashish in an old kibashi by the lamp. And this one is Bus East. Society has good intentions. Bureaucracy is like a friend 5 years ago. Other furies are the losses. America's trying to control the uncontrollable forest fires. Vice, the essential smile in the only essential sleep of the children of essential mind. I'm all through playing the American. Now I'm going to live a good, quiet life. The world should be built for footwalkers. Oily on spiny Nevada.
My people go. Let my people go.
Free my people.
Tell Pharaoh.
Let my people go.
That was The Sounds of Blackness and Let My People Go. Another poem now from Jack Kerouac, and this is First Chorus, Mexico City Blues. But magic of ignorance, but magic is the same as no but. All one light, one rough roads, one high iron main way. Denver is the same. The guy I was with, his uncle was the governor of Wyoming. Of course he paid me back. 10 days, 2 weeks, stock and join, John. Was an old crook anyway. The same voice on the same ship. The supreme vehicle, SS Excalibur. Maynard Mainline, Mountain. Merudhaga, Merzen of Missy. This poem is entitled, again by Jack Kerouac, 10th Chorus Mexico City Blues. The great hanging weak teat of India on the map. The fingernail of Malaya. The wall of China. The Korea T-puss thumb. The salamander Japan. The Okinawa moonspot. The Pacific. The back of Hawaiian mountains. Coconuts. Klein's, balconies, R. Tarzan, and W.D. Griffith, the great American director, strolling down disgruntled Hollywood Lane to Toot, Nebraska. Indian Village, New York, Atlantis, Rome, Peleus, and Melisander, and swans of balls, spots on the of the foam on the ocean. And another Jack Kerouac poem. This is 4th Chorus Mexico City Blues. Roosevelt was worth $6.7 million. He was tight. Frog waits till the poor fly flies past. And then they got him. The pool of clear rocks covered with vegetable scum. Covered the rocks, clear the pool. Covered the warm surface. Covered the lotus. Dusted the lemon flower, aerial the pad, clean, queer the clear blue water, and then they got him. The oil of the olive, bittersweet taffies, bittersweet cabbage, cabbage soup made right, a hunk of grass, sauerkraut let work in a big barrel, stunk but good. You're listening to Radio JCOM on the internet and on YouTube. My name is Candace Grant, and I have many more poems for you. The next one is The Thrush by Edward Thomas. When winter's ahead, what can you read in November that you read in April? When winter's dead, I hear the thrush, and I see him alone at the end of the lane, near the bare poplar's tip, singing continuously. It's more than you know than that, even as in April, so in November. Winter is gone that must go. Or is all your law not to call November, November, and April, April, and winter, winter, no more? But I know all the months all, and their sweet names, April and May and June and October. As you call and call, I must remember what died into April and consider what will be born of a fair November. And April I love for what it was born of, and November for what will die in, for what they are and what they are not. While you love what is kind, what you can sing in and what can love and forget in, all that is ahead and behind. Next, we have a sonnet from William Shakespeare. This is sonnet number 98. From you have I been absent in the spring, when proud pied April, dressed in all his trim, hath put a spirit of youth in everything. That heavy Saturn laughed and leaped with him. Yet, nor the lays of birds, nor the sweet smell of different flowers in odour and in hue, could make any summer's stories tell. Or, from their proud lap pluck them where they grew. Nor did I wonder at the lily's white, nor praise the deep vermilion in the rose. They were but sweet, but figures of delight, drawn after you, pattern of all those. Yet seemed it winter still, and you away, as with your shadow I with these did play. Next we have Young Lambs by John Clare. The spring is coming by a many signs. The trays are up and the hedges broken down that fence the haystack, and the remnants shine like some old antique fragment weathered brown. And where the sun peeps in every sheltered place, the little early buttercups unfold a glittering star or two, till many trace the edges of the black thorn clumps in gold. And then a little lamb bolts up behind the hill and wags his tail to meet the yoe. And then another, sheltered from the wind, lies all his length as death, and lets me go close by, and never stirs but baking lies, with stretched out as though he could not rise. Next we have the Enkindled Spring by D.H. Lawrence. This spring, as it comes, burst up in bonfire green, wild puffing of emerald trees and flame-filled bushes, thorn blossom lifting in wreaths of smoke between where the wood fumes up and the watery flickering rushes. I am amazed at this spring, this conflagration of green fires lit on the soil of the earth, this blaze of growing and sparks that puff in wild gyration, faces of people streaming across my gaze. And what fountain of fire am I among this leaping combustion of spring? My spirit is lost about like a shadow buffeted in the throng of flames, a shadow that's gone away and is lost. And my next poem is Miracle on St. David's Day by Gillian Clark. They flash upon that inward eye which is the bliss of solitude, an afternoon yellow and open mouth with daffodils. The sun treads the path among cedars and enormous oaks. It might be a country house, guests strolling the rumps of gardeners between the shrubs. I am reading poetry to the insane. An old woman, interrupting, offers as many buckets of coal as I need. A beautiful chestnut-haired boy listens entirely absorbed, a schizophrenic on a good day, they tell me later. In a cage of 1st March sun, a woman sits not listening, not seeing, not feeling. In her neat clothes, the woman is absent. A big, mild man is tenderly led to his chair. He has never spoken. His labourer's hands on his knees, he rocks gently to the rhythms of the poems. I read to their presences, absences, to the big, dumb, labouring man as he rocks. He is suddenly standing silently, huge and mild, but I feel afraid. Like slow movement of spring water, or the first bird of the year in the breaking darkness, the labourer's voice recites the daffodils. The nurses are frozen, alert. The patients seem to listen. He is hoarse, but word perfect. Outside, the daffodils are still as wax. 1,000, 10,000, their syllables unspoken, their creams and yellows still. 40 years ago, in a valley school, the class recited poetry by rote. Since the dumbness of the misery fell, he has remembered where there was music of speech that once he had to say. And when he's done, before the applause, we observe a flower's silence. A thrush sings and the daffodils are flame. And then here is I Watched a Blackbird by Thomas Hardy. I watched a blackbird on a budding sycamore. One Easter day, when sap was stirring twigs to the core, I saw his tongue and crocus-coloured bill parting and closing as he turned to his trill. Then he flew down, seized on a spent stem of hay, and up to where his building scheme was underway, as if so sure a nest was never shaped on spray. So that's about it for this week. A huge thank you to my producer, Noel Sumroy, for his immense patience. And to finish this time, I'm going to read you Holding Out for a Hero by Bonnie Tyler. Where have all the good men gone, and where are all the gods? Where's the streetwise Hercules to fight the rising odds? Isn't there a white knight upon a fiery steed? Late at night I toss and turn, and I dream of what I need. I need a hero. I'm holding out for a hero till the end of night. He's got to be strong and he's got to be fast, and he's got to be fresh from the fight. I need a hero. I'm holding out for a hero till the morning light. He's got to be sure and he's got to be soon, and he's got to be larger than life. Somewhere, after midnight, in my wildest fantasy, somewhere, just beyond my reach, there is someone reaching back for me, racing on in the thunder and rising with the heat. It's going to take a Superman to sweep me off my feet.
Jacob.